Taste this!
Wow.
Yes, that's what I'm talking about.
So what do you know about dim sum?
Hi, welcome to Taste This TV. I'm Chef Joe Ciminera.
Remember, there are no rules in cooking.
Taste some food and have a great time on Taste This. I bet you I can eat this whole thing.
Here you have it, my version of the duck.
Thanks for having me here today. It's
an absolute pleasure. Thanks for having me on the show.
Grab a fresh lobster, cook it, and this is a lobster roll. One of my favorite events, the Big Apple Barbecue.
I'm Chef Joseph Ciminera. Remember, there are no rules in cooking. Taste this.
All right, well, we're going to get started on a great recipe today. We have Garofalo pasta, which we're going to be using as a side accompaniment. You know, before we start to actually fillet some of the salmon here and chili and sea bass, because you see the skin is on this fish, what we're going to do is talk a little bit about what I have here. These are king crab legs. Now, king crab legs are definitely prized. Everyone loves them, and they're very expensive. What I like to do with the king crab legs is they're going to arrive to you cooked already. What I like to do is take a professional culinary shears, a scissors, and basically just cut the meat out. All right, now, see all this really good meat? I'm putting it in the beans. One thing I found over the years when incorporating beans with fish and stuff, look at all this great knuckle meat there. This is really good to actually put it into the beans. It gives it an extra kind of seafood flavor. You know, the best tool with this is going to be your fingers once you get past the point of cutting this. We got one more. Look at all the meat in this baby. Stick your finger in there and get all that stuff out. That's really good stuff there. There you go. Don't leave nothing out. Good. And we got this little piece here. And these scissors are really good. I mean, they will cut your finger off. So you have to... You have to watch out on when you're using them, but they're usually called like poultry shears or poultry scissors. They'll go right through the bone really quick. But they're just better than your typical, you know, nutcracker that you see out there. I mean, look, you get the whole piece out in its entirety. Good. Okay, put that there like that. Scissor back, get cleaned up a little bit over here. I want to talk about filleting some of this fish. We're going to start with our salmon today. Now, when you're talking about salmon, what we're doing here is we're going to make a crust. Technically, this crust is called the St. Peter's crust, which is the St. Peter's fish, which is either wolf fish or tilapia. Today, we're actually going to be using the salmon to crust as well because panko breadcrumbs, which is what we're going to be using, really goes well with this. So you got to get your fillet knife nice and sharp. Now, there's a couple of ways of cooking salmon. You could actually put salmon down on the grill. Maybe I'll just show you that technique anyway. All right, let's do this. I wasn't going to do that, but I'll do it. All right, you got our fish here. We're going to cut it in half. Now, you see the skin is on here? Many people don't know, but you can cook down that skin and go right underneath the fish when it's cooked. So what we're going to do is take our salmon, and we're just going to leave that there. Now we're going to take this piece. By the way, I always like a dry towel because I always, you know, when you're working with your hands and stuff like that, well, use a towel that, you know, if you threw it away, you're not going to cry about it. All right, now we're going to be cutting this baby. Okay, and we got our fish. We got our skin we don't need. What I like to do is just trim the fish up a little bit just for even cooking. Okay. Next, we'll season the fish with a little salt. And we'll take a combination of both butter and oil. Now, you know, the importance of searing fish are that, you know, you need a hot pan and you need a lot of oil. You need a good amount of butter, too. All right, we're on low flame here, low heat. Everybody's like, oh, you need to use a nonstick pan, but you really don't need to for this. You know, as long as the pan is hot, you'll do it good. Your salt side goes down first. And when you get the fish in there, just do this. kind of move your fish around a little bit and just leave it kind of sitting there doing its thing. All right, we're gonna take this, move it in the back. I'm gonna wash off our knife real quick. And you know, cooking, especially with fish, at low temperatures, you know, you could just kind of walk away from it. You know, don't feel that, you know, you got too much going on, because this is really easy stuff here. All right, now we have our Chilean sea bass, which is probably considered the more of expensive fishes. Now Chilean, I always cut down the center here. You take your Chilean sea bass, and there you go. That's what I'm talking about. Now this piece right here, a little salt, a little bit of oil, goes right down on the grill. All right, this other piece of fish we're not going to do anything with yet. I'm just going to put that in the back. Now, two cuts of fish that I like happen to be the salmon and happen to be the Chilean sea bass. Both are easily accessible. You can get them, no problems, no issues. Which one tastes better? I don't know. I tend to think that they're both oily fishes. They're both good. They have distinct flavors, which I like. You know, my preference would probably be salmon if I had to choose. You know, but I like Chilean sea bass a lot too. I just think I could eat salmon a lot more, personally. All right, so we've chopped up our crab, our king crab legs, in with our beans. And we got our hot saute pan here. What we're going to do is we're going to put a little oil in here first. And then I'm going to take some basil pesto. Take it off the fire and throw the whole thing in there like so. And we look at this and determine, you know, how much more pesto do we want in there, how much more oil. You know, we'll add just a little bit of oil in there, which would be good. And I think a little more greens would add to this dish. All right, we're just gonna kind of leave it sitting in there. If you wanted to add some stock in there, you could. But again, what I'm gonna do here is deglaze this with some sparkling wine. So it's not like I need a bunch of liquid all over the plate. And I like to make plates that are kind of small anyway. So, I mean, we'll be in a good place with that. Now, let's talk about some toppings that we'll be making for this fish. One is when you're doing some type of crust, and I'll get a bowl here just to show you in a minute. When you're crusting like salmons and different kinds of fishes and stuff like that, you want to have what's called, you know, your base, your mayonnaise base, so to speak. I have some creme fraiche here that I have. Creme fraiche is definitely like sour cream. I happen to think it has a much more elegant flavor. So what we're going to do is just put a little bit of creme fraiche in here. Now, creme fraiche really goes great with different kinds of fishes. Now, we got a little bit of creme fraiche, but creme fraiche doesn't come seasoned. So just put a little salt in there like so. Take a little bit of your black olive spread. Now, the black olive spread is good because it cuts through a lot of the fat. Black olive spread and salmon really go hand in hand. Now, you don't have to be a rocket scientist and learn how to make this stuff, because you can buy it already made. Same thing with the pestos. And you can leave this stuff in your refrigerator for so long and not have to really worry about, you know, will it go bad. We have a little bit of sun-dried tomato pesto. And we have these red onions that I grilled. What I did was I sliced them, put them on a grill, waited for them to cool, and then just diced them. Real simple stuff. Let's raise that a little bit. And what we're going to do is put some in there as well. The onions really add to a nice flavor. Tastes nice and caramelized. It really is a must. Now here go our breadcrumbs. There's going to be two stages which we're going to do this. We're going to put a good amount in there and mix it. And at the very end, just before we mix this baby and put it on top of the salmon, we're going to put some more. What the breadcrumbs will do, not only in add flavor, but they'll absorb any liquid. So your top paste will actually go on smooth. Another thing is, we're not using any raw crab or shrimp. We didn't make a mousseline on here, so it's not raw. We don't have to worry about baking it in the broiler or the oven. We can do this all in one pan, which is exactly what I'm going to do, and it's exactly how I'm going to show you. Okay, a little bit more, and we're good. We're going to let that just sit up. One thing about panko, Japanese breadcrumbs, they're not like the regular breadcrumbs that you would use for, like, chicken cutlets. They take a little while to soak into the moisture. Okay, good. That's exactly what we want. It's pasty. We'll be able to mold it. And a little while longer, that'll actually soak up any extra liquid that came out. Now, what do we do while we're waiting for this? Well, I think we're just about ready to turn this fish over. What we should have is a nice brown, which we do, a nice seared look. It's really nice the way we go. And you see how the fish is not sticking to the bottom? That's exactly what I was telling you about it before. If you move that around in the beginning, you're going to be good. We lowered that. Beans are looking good. Now, we have some pasta that we made here earlier today, and I'm saying to myself, you know, don't let the pasta go to waste. What can we do with it, right? So we got some pesto here. We got some pesto here, too. And we have a lot of olive oil. We're just going to move that around. And I'm going to save this for an aside accompaniment. People who like pasta, especially in my house, that's like an everyday thing. And this is wonderful pasta. This is Garofalo pasta. Okay, we're going to leave our pasta over there. Next, we're getting ready to deglaze some of our... See what I'm talking about? Now this is really coming together, smelling nice. We're going to take our fish and just going to take a little bit of oil out of there. And we're going to raise the fire, and now we're going to deglaze it with a little bit of that sparkling wine that we talked about. Now today we're going to be using the Verdi Sparkolatini, their peach flavor, the Italian fun. And we're just going to deglaze this fish. And then we're going to take some butter, unsalted of course, and just kind of let that cook down. At the same time, what we're going to do, let's turn this fish over because I smell it's got to turn over. All right, looking good. Nice. That's exactly what we're looking for. Now, remember what I told you about the salmon and the skin earlier? I said that if you put the skin on the grill, you would probably go right underneath the salmon. See how that comes right off? And then just turn it over. Here's what the skin looks like. See, so you don't even need to take the skin off if you feel like you're not a skilled, you know, butcher, so to speak, and you think you're going to hack off more meat than skin, here you go. Comes right off. All right, so both of our fish have a little bit of time left. I got some freeze-dried herb de Provence I'm just going to put in there for the salmon. Now, we can kind of let this baby cook down a little bit, give us a nice liquid. Now, what we're going to do is we have our crusting that we talked about. We're going to go over to our fish and just add the crust to it. It's already cooked. It's already seasoned. It just needs to be warmed up. All right. Now, we're going to start to plate up our first dish, which is our beans. Now, we talked about our beans here. Now, you could use just about any bean that you'd like. I'm using cannellini beans. I've always felt cannellini beans really went well with salmon. But then again, I'm not stuck to it. You know, you can totally use, you know, navy beans or kidney beans and stuff like that. What I'm saying is I think that you'll have better success when it comes to the bean department if you use cannellini. Now, we're going to take our beans. Now, we talked about what we did here with this crab meat. Crab meat, beans. What we're going to do is put this in the center. Now, already I could smell an intense seafood flavor, right? If you love king crab legs, and I didn't use a lot. I mean, if you had to buy that, it probably would have been like 11 bucks at the store or something like that. You see, this is definitely a generous portion for two. I'm just going to put a little bit down in there. Now, our starch is beans. I guess you could say our vegetable is pesto. You know, you don't have to use it. And then what you might want to do is take a little bit of olive here, olive spread, and just spread it down on the plate a little bit. Now, we'll come back over here and see how we're doing. You see how our sauce is getting thicker? Now what we're going to do is take our wonderful sauce that we just created here, go over the top with it, basting it. Now we're good. But if you notice, you know, with this dish that we did, you see how our crust is in place? We put just enough so that even by basting the top with all this wonderful juices and liquid that we're doing, you're not in a position where your breadcrumbs are running off your fish. And I think that's where the mess of it comes in, with some of these restaurants thinking that they could stuff fish, comes out in a sloppy mess. Next thing you know, you can't tell what the sauce is or if it's a stuffing. So anyway, take this fish off. This fish is totally done at this point. We're going to go right on top of the beans. Okay, and it just sits on there. A good cooked fish, mid-rail, just sit on there, no worries. Right? Now, we said we got a little bit of that olive pesto going down there because we substituted before. What we're going to do is take some liquid and go right over the top of the fish. This is really good stuff. And the butter helps it. The butter helps it, but you can't do it without the oil either, because then it would have been burnt butter, which is actually a classical French dish, but definitely not suitable for this one. And then we have some petite microgreens that we did earlier, and we could just put those at the top. All right, so our first salmon dish is done. We can put that over there. You know, we'll recap that in a minute once we get back to it. All right, so now we're going to take off our Chilean sea bass, and we're going to leave that to the front here. Now, what goes great with Chilean sea bass are greens. Now, we're going to talk about these greens a little bit. I have sorrel, silver leaf, red oak. Now, these are baby microgreens, and we're going to put that inside the bowl. You can see this in a second here. And we got some tangerine leaf. And all these microgreens are really special because they take on a certain flavor, as a farmer would infuse these and grow them. So in other words, if you have something that's called cucumber, which this is right here, micro cucumber, these greens would not normally taste like cucumber because of the way it's grown and the way it's enhanced, I should say, you have a cucumber flavor to it. In fact, they're so potent that you could take the green and smash it with your hand a little bit and smell it. And next thing we have is carrot fern. I've said this before that you don't want to go eating carrot ferns. These are the tops of the carrots, by the way. By themselves, unless you have other greens to kind of complement it. And that's about it. What we're going to do is add a little bit of olive oil and a little bit of salt, because we don't want to take away anything from these natural greens. And it's okay to use your hands too. You know, even by adding an acid, unless you're going to add it a la minute, probably isn't going to be a good thing. These greens are very, very potent in the way of their flavor, but their structure is very weak. So you don't want to be in a situation where you're putting a heavy acid in here. These things will just die out. And this type of fish, when it's grilled like that, goes really well with these types of microgreens. I mean, this is beautiful. Look at these leaves like this. You know what I'm saying? You don't want to add anything to the dish that'll take away from it at all. And even our salmon that we have back there grilling still, you have a situation where you can take that and freeze it, put it in a sandwich or what have you. All right, so let's go over some of the fish that we have here. We have our salmon. Now, there's a difference between coho salmon, wild salmon, farm-raised salmon. And for years, I'm sure you've heard the news out there, so it's no secret that the wild-caught salmon definitely is the best salmon, because what happens with the farm-raised salmon is it's in a controlled environment where they're feeding the fish, sometimes dies, the redness of the shrimp to change the inside of the color to the fish to make it red. Wild caught salmon has a bit of a red tint to it. It's the same color as tamar, but just a bit red. If you go to Alaska and you have salmon there, wild caught salmon right out of the sea, you're going to notice the fish looks somewhat red when you gut it. It's got great flavor to it, but unfortunately, that wild caught salmon is probably over $20-something a pound, as opposed to the farm raised, which is probably in the area around like 16 or whatever, and that goes up and down, so you really can't stay with the price quote. But there is a difference. And then you have coho salmon, which is even one of the more expensive salmons as well. Now, the Chilean sea bass will almost 99% of the time arrive at a fish manger or a fish market frozen. You know, so there's really no way that you can get this fish fresh. But it's one of the only fish I've found that when it comes in frozen and thaws, you could never really know that it's frozen. It's got a great, clean, milky taste. What I mean by that is it's not as oily as the salmon, but the Chilean sea bass has a very milky texture on your palate. And the fish doesn't taste good, in my opinion, unless you have a charred top or a charred bottom, because you need that crispiness to really melt through the flavors. Now, one thing that's good about Chilean sea bass, because it's so milky, you don't want to get into a situation of creating a heavy sauce with it. So what I think is acceptable to the fish is leaving it with some type of bitter green, something light that'll only complement the flavor, not take it away. If you put a heavy sauce on this, you're not going to be able to taste the flavor of the fish. So that's why we put microgreens on here, which I'm getting a lot, getting into some microgreens and where they're from, what their taste is. And we've developed flavors and textures and combination of microgreens that enhance the flavor of this fish. So, I mean, that's it for these two dishes that I love, and I hope you love them too. So, hey, thank you for joining me on this episode of Taste This TV. I'm your host, Chef Joseph Ciminera. Remember, there are no rules in cooking. Taste this.